I begin this morning with excerpts from Ek Onkar Satnam, Heartbeat of Nanak. This book was published by AUTHORHOUSE in UK in July this year. It is available at leading bookstores, WATERSTONE in England, NILES in Australia and New Zealand, Barnes & Nobles in United States, and many other stores, both in print form as well as ebook format. It is also available at Amazon.com. I will start sharing the excerpts in a chronological order, because when you do random excerpts, it becomes difficult to know which has been done and which has not been. The first excerpt is Mool Mantra. Mool means basic, mantra means sutra, the message of Guru Nanak. The first sutra of Guru Nanak is Ek Onkar Satnam. Karta Purukh Nirbhav Nirbhair Akal Murat Ajuni Saibham Guru Prasad Jap. There is one universal creator God. Thy name is Truth. Creative being personified, born out of his own free will, without any fear, no hatred, beyond birth and death, something that is born out of its own free will, not as a process of male-female ovum-sperm interaction, and beyond birth too, self-existent, cause of its own existence. How can one attain to this? Certainly by the grace of the Master alone. Mool Mantra, as it is known as in Sikh religion, has two parts: invocation and explanation of the attributes. Invocation finishes in three words. As is the customary etiquette, before one begins the message, there is invocation. The invocation comes first, Ek Onkar Satnam. Ek means one, Onkar means that existential sound that was there in the beginning, that is there, and that will be there when there is dissolution, when the creation comes to an end. Such is the nature of that which is existential. You see something now, next moment it is not there. A bubble forms, a wave surfaces, but the next moment wave is not there. It disappears. But truth is that which always is. This existential sound, which is the pulse of the cosmos, is existential. It existed then, it exists now, it will exist till eternity lasts. And what is its nature? This is truth. Truth alone. Entire Sikh religion, the message of Guru Nanak, is finished in three words. Ek means one, that which is one. Everything else is the extension of that. And its nature is the existential sound, the uncreated. When all the noise, the clatter of the mind disappears, then suddenly you hear something which is existential. Every morning birds chirp, but if you have a blaring music playing, your radio playing, your conversation going on, your cell phone on, or something else, Because of all these other things, you will not be able to hear the chirping of the birds. The moment your television is off, your radio set is off, and all other noise is no more, suddenly you hear the chirping of the birds. The Onkar is the pulse of the cosmos, the very cause of the being, the cause of the existence. This is the essence, and Ek Onkar Satnam is invocation as well. The entire Sikh religion is condensed in these three words. After this, all that Nanak spoke is explanation. Not everyone is at the same plane of consciousness as Nanak is. Not everyone can understand the words of master like Nanak. And if that has been the case, then there was no need for Nanak. All explanations are needed for your understanding. This is the methodology or tariqat or the way of Nanak to bring transformation in you. This is the way for the transformation of human consciousness. Ek Onkar Satnam is the remembrance and salutations of that which is. And there is no better way than remembering the attributes of that which is. Remembering, I am not saying chanting. Remembering the attributes of that which is. There is a significant difference between invocation you do and the invocation of Nanak. The words Nanak is using as attributes are his experience. And it is out of experience that these words emerge that Nanak had used. These are the words of the one who has known. When a master uses certain words, there is certainly a difference. He is not using the words unconsciously like you. In fact, it is the master who gives his fragrance to these words. Each word that Nanak has used echoes his fragrance and the taste of his being. Nanak experienced his beloved, and out of that experience, these words overflow. Before I go into the actual text, it is important to know something about the birth of Japji. Only then we will be able to enter the being of Nanak through the message of Japji Sahib. Prelude to the birth of Japji Sahib. It was one dark night in the month of rainy season, thunder, in between lightning, periodic pangs of rain. The entire village was asleep. Only the lamp is lit in Nanak's room. Thunder, lightning. In between the sound of the raindrops falling on the roof breaks the stillness of the night. An indrawn stillness echoes. An indrawn stillness echoes. Until late that night, Nanak continued singing. Night entered the third quarter. Nanak's mother feared. She gave a gentle knock at the door. Mother Tripta said, "Son, go to sleep now. The night is about to disappear. It is almost daybreak. Son, go to sleep now." Nanak got silent. Same time, amidst the dark stillness of the night, a bird Papiha echoed the sound Pihu Pihu. This bird is called Pihu Pihu, means beloved, beloved. That is how the sound comes up. It continues to look at the moon, and the sound that comes out of, that emerges out of this bird is known as Pihu Pihu. As if it is calling, "Where are you, my beloved?" There is a lament, "Where are you?" Nanak drew the attention of his mother towards this sound and said, "Mother, are you listening to the sound of this bird? This bird is not asleep as yet. Its song continues like the clarion call. Day and night the bird continues its lament of separation with its beloved. Day and night the bird continued its lament of separation with its beloved. I am in competition with this bird. It is calling to its beloved. Then how can I be silent? I will continue to sing as long as this bird continues to call. It is the call of the being. It is the call out of the separation. I will continue to sing as long as this bird continues to call. Its beloved is close by, but my beloved is far. I do not know where. Even if I continue to live for lives, then I can reach. Only then I can reach. In love one does not count days." And thus Nanak continued singing. Nanak reached to the ultimate through singing. Nanak's path is full of songs. His search is unique. Remember, Nanak did no yoga, no tap, no meditation, no dhyan. He simply sang and thus attained to oneness with the ultimate. Nanak sang with so much totality that his song became his meditation, song became his yoga, song became tap or austerities. An ecstatic Kabir sings, "Surat kalhari matwari madhwa pi gai bintole." Surat means awareness. Matwari means is intoxicated. The consciousness has become intoxicated. Now it seeks nothing else but the beloved alone. Madhwa means nectar. You drink nectar or a drink, maybe a cup. You may take alcoholic beverage, 1 peg, 2 peg, 3 peg, but not to immeasurable quantum. It never happens that way. Nanak is the one who drank this mystical wine to immeasurable quantum, to his heart's content. Nanak continued to sing the rest of the life. Such songs are not the songs of an ordinary singer. Whenever anyone asks a question to Nanak, Nanak will begin to sing, and all his message emerged through singing. These pauris, as these are known as in Sikh religion, in Gurbani, the message of the masters, the scriptures, it is known as the message of the masters in the form of songs. Such songs are not therefore the songs of an ordinary singer. These are the songs of the one who has known truth. These songs echo the ultimate experience of truth or oneness. These songs reflect the very being of God, or Rab, as Nanak calls him. Having drunk, Nanak is now overflowing that which cannot be put into the words. What he is putting in the form of words through these songs is his ecstasy, his joy, his celebrations. Only an enchanting heart can feel Nanak and his energy field. Having drunk, Nanak is now overflowing that which cannot be put into the words. What is that which cannot be put into the words? The more you try to put into the words, but words are incapable. Nanak experienced the magnanimity, his joy, his bliss, his celebration. That is what he is trying to put into the words. The energy of Nanak cannot be destroyed by any means. Only an enchanting heart can become a medium of communion. only an enchanting heart. If your heart is mathematically logical, you cannot understand the message of Nanak. A mathematician, a logician cannot understand the message of Nanak. Let me speak something of the birth of Japji Sahib. The dark night of the rainy season that I spoke of earlier, and then Nanak was 16 to 17 years of age. When Japji was born, Nanak was 36 years, 6 months and 15 days old. When Japji was born, Nanak was 36 years, 6 months and 15 days old. The night that I spoke of earlier, Nanak was an aspirant. That night he was in search of his beloved. The search has just begun. The call for the beloved is continuing, pihu, pihu. The bird was still calling. Union had not yet happened. The flower has not yet blossomed. But the bud has its beauty, fragrance and aura as well. But the bud has its beauty, fragrance and aura as well. We give rose buds as symbol of love. Whenever an individual does any act with so much totality, that alone becomes the path. Anything done halfway, be it meditation or anything else, cannot lead to ultimate flowering. Certainly you will reach. It matters not what you do. If you sing with your whole being, dance totally, certainly you will reach. It matters not what you do. What really matters is how you do. Whether you are totally into it, or you are saying I love you but you are thinking of someone else, then your I love you is insipid and meaningless. When your whole being says, sings, dances, then there is a totally a different flavor. What really matters is how you do, how totally you are into it, and the question is of your totality. Just as atom cannot be destroyed, so too consciousness cannot be destroyed. Scientists have harnessed atomic energy only for destructive purposes so far. But Nanak has harnessed the energy field of consciousness for the transformation of human beings. Feel it, be it. Nanak's effort is the birth of a new man out of you, the integrated, harmonized and blissful, one who lives life beyond duality. Japji Sahib is the announcement of Nanak's union with God. Japji Sahib is the announcement of Nanak's union with God. The bird has now united with its beloved. The lament of Pihu Pihu is over now. After this solemn union with his beloved, Japji is the message of Nanak. It contains 38 sutras known as paudis, and then one Mool mantra, and then the last mantra. Japji is the being of Nanak. Nanak's compassion overflows through Japji Sahib. Japji is the fragrance of Nanak. Therefore, in the message of Nanak, Japji occupies a very significant place. Most sublime of Nanak's message is Japji. Japji is most authentic, sublime, and the recent message from the unknown and unknowable. Japji is the first words that overflowed through Nanak after the union with his beloved. Let us submerge into the events that led to the birth of Japji Sahib. In the darkness of the night, on the bank of the river, Nanak continued sitting till late in the night along with his disciple and attendant Mardana. On the bank of the river, Nanak remained sitting till late in the night along with his disciple and attendant Mardana. All of a sudden, Nanak took off his clothes. All of a sudden, Nanak took off his clothes. Without a single word, Nanak entered the river. Mardana followed and kept on asking, "What are you doing? Night is cold and dark." Far he went in the river and disappeared from the sight of Mardana. Nanak took a dive. Mardana thought in a few moments Nanak will come out. But Nanak did not emerge. Nanak did not come out of the river. For 5 to 10 minutes Mardana waited. Then he started searching for Nanak. He started calling. Then he started sprinting along the shore. "Where are you? Respond." Mardana felt as if each wave is responding. "Have patience. Wait a little longer." But there was no trace of Nanak. Only a deep feeling was there within Mardana. "Have patience. Wait a little longer." But there was no trace of Nanak. Mardana ran to the village. Midnight he woke up everyone. Crowd gathered. Everyone loved Nanak dearly. People saw a rare possibility in Nanak, a possibility of blossoming. In the presence of Nanak, everyone felt a different aura, a new fragrance. Flower has not yet blossomed, yet still the bud has its beauty. And the fragrance too. Entire village started crying. People gathered. They searched the entire river but found no trace of Nanak. 3 days passed. It was accepted either Nanak drowned or some animal has eaten Nanak. It was accepted that Nanak died. There seemed to be no possibility of Nanak coming back. Sudden demise of Nanak was accepted. 3 days after, Nanak appeared from the river suddenly. 3 days after, Nanak appeared from the river suddenly. As Nanak appeared from the river, Japji is his first message. As Nanak appeared from the river, Japji is his first message. Nanak made this announcement. Such is a story. Such is the story. I say a story. A story means it is true and it is not true at the same time. It indicates truth and it is not true because it indicates in symbols. And deeper the message is, one has to search for deeper and more subtle symbols. When Nanak disappeared in the river for 3 days, the story says Nanak appeared in front of his beloved God. Nanak experienced totality. He came face to face with God, found his beloved in front of his eyes, one whom Nanak called day and night through his songs, found in front of his eyes, for whom all his songs were addressed, one who was his heartbeat, one who was the cause of his existence, found right in front of his eyes. Nanak is fulfilled. This is what normally happens. You had been waiting for someone for years and all of a sudden the person appears. It is like a deja vu. You are stuck down. You are fulfilled. God said, "Now you go back. All that I have bestowed upon you, share the same with people." This is how it happens with every master. Something is showered onto him. with a promise from him that he will go and share it unrestricted. Share whatever has been showered onto him unconditionally, without any prejudice, without any reward, just out of sheer joy, all that has been showered is shared. Such is the understanding between the known and the unknown, the master and his beloved, one who showers everything. Returning from this communion, Japji Sahib is the offering of Nanak. Japji is the first offering. Japji Sahib is the first offering of Nanak after emerging from the river. When I said Nanak disappeared in the river for 3 days, he appeared in front of the beloved, found the beloved in front of his eyes, one for whom he sang, one for whom he spent sleepless nights, one that existed within him like a deep thirst, found in front of his eyes. One that existed within him like a deep thirst, found him, now found him in front of his eyes. Eyes are fulfilled with joy. Satiation happened. Insatiable quest is fulfilled now. His beloved asks him now to return and share all that he has filled him with. Japji is the first offering of Nanak to humanity. After this communion with his beloved, Japji is the first words that evolved out of Nanak. Japji is the ecstasy of Nanak. Japji is the ecstasy of Nanak. Nothing is more sublime in the message of Nanak than Japji. Japji is the being of Nanak, his fragrance. This is a story. And I say this is a story. Try to understand its symbols. Unless you disappear, there can be no communion. When I say you disappear, means let your conditioning, let your mind, all that you claim to have known disappears. What is this paradox? Until you disappear. And if I disappear, then who will meet? Who will be in front of God? This you need to understand. You are not what you ought to be. You are not one. You are divided. There is utter confusion and conflict within. You cannot see that a seed is flower. Can you see that seed is flower? No. All this happens because of the false center ego, your conditionings. Your thinking. You have been conditioned to be a particular way, a Hindu or Christian or Muslim, a Catholic or Protestant. But this is false center. False center is created into you. You are human being first, and the rest is conditioning. Conditioned as a Hindu, as a Sikh, as a Muslim, as a Christian, or so on and so forth. So when I say until you disappear, it refers to the disappearance of ego and your conditioning. Ego has to dissolve, your conditionings have to vanish, only then your real face will appear. And remember, this is the first criteria. How does ego disappear? It matters not. It disappeared in case of Nanak when he drowned in the river for 3 days. It is insignificant whether you disappear in the river or mountain or forest through meditation or devotion. It does not matter really. It does not matter really whether you disappear in the river or the mountains or forest through meditation or devotion or any other method. None of these things really matter. What really matters is that you disappear. Your conditionings vanish. Where and how you disappear matters not. Your very presence is the obstruction. You are standing. Your conditioning is standing like a China wall. This is the reason that the story says Nanak disappeared in the river. So too you have to disappear. Your ego has to vanish. It takes minimum 3 days for the process of death to complete. This is the reason when someone dies, we celebrate the third day ceremony. For the process of death to complete, minimum it takes 3 days. That much time is needed. So too, ego never dies instantaneously. Slowly and slowly it dissolves. And it takes 3 days. This is the reason there is a gap of 3 days that Nanak disappeared for 3 days. Whenever someone enters into meditation, he becomes useless for the outer world. He becomes almost absent for the outer world. Nanak disappeared in the river for 3 days. Nanak remained in the river for 3 days. Ego dissolved completely. Man exists as ego alone. Ego feels happy, sad, etc. All that you do is the outcome of ego. This happens until ego dissolves completely. Thereafter, a new journey begins. Family, friends, and relatives can only see ego when you grumble. They know your presence. Family, friends, and relatives can only see ego when you grumble, when you get angry, and things like these. Whenever you are quiet, unconcerned, not complaining, then nobody knows your presence. If you do not create tantrums, you're just sitting down in your room and someone comes and wants to know if this person is in the home or not. Someone will say, I don't know. I haven't seen this person. Since morning I haven't seen. Let me check in the room if the person is there or not. So when you are not existing as ego, you become non-existent for your family, friends, and relatives. If you are not operating as ego, you do not have any existence. It is only ego that has existence. If you do not grumble from morning till evening, experiment one day. Nobody will know your presence. Nobody will know that you are at home or not. Because your presence is recognized at home because of tantrums that you create throughout the day. When the food is brought, there is a tantrum. When something else happens, when you are not finding your things, there is chaos. Then your presence is felt. One day try not to interfere in anything, not to expect anything from anyone, not to be bothered, not with the anger, frustration, or any complaint or whatsoever. No one will miss you. No one will feel your presence. If you are not operating as ego, you do not have any existence. Sometimes you would have observed this happens to you as well. We do not have eyes to see soul. So it was considered that Nanak drowned or died. As I said, you exist as ego. When someone hurts you, every time you see someone, your mother, your father, brother, sister, you complain. Anyone comes, you complain that how could this man, how could this woman say so about me? You exist as ego. Not, you have no taste of soul, the being, the silence. And the moment you do that, you become non-existent for the society, family and friends. Because it is the family and friends and relatives that forms the society around him. Whenever one begins the inward journey, he becomes futile for the outer world. Now he is no more. He He does not behave as you are in the normal way. It is said, how come that you are not behaving in the normal way? See the fallacy of the words. When you are existing as ego, grumbling, getting angry, this is normal. And when you are not behaving in that way, it is considered that your behavior is abnormal. This is the kind of the hypocritic world we live in. Everyone has to live in this kind of world. Whether you want to be a part of this or not, that is your choice. And the moment you make a choice that you are not going to be the part of this chaotic, the world, your inward journey has begun. Whenever one begins the inward journey, he becomes futile for the outer world. Now he is no more. He does not behave in the normal way. There is a discontinuity. Past is no more. New is now born. This is the reason that this story has the gap of 3 days. In that gap of 3 days, the past disappeared. New is born. This is the reason that this story has the gap of 3 days. The symbol of 3 days. 3 days after Nanak returned. On the inward path, whoever begins the journey certainly returns, but returns as refurbished, as new, as reborn. Certainly, whosoever moves on the path ultimately returns to the world of beings. He returns to share all that he has experienced through his communing. On his way to the merger with the totality, he was thirsty. His quench is satiated now. He was a beggar while he was going, but now he returns as an emperor. Emperor not of the outer world, instead of inner. Now he is connected to an unfathomable ocean of bliss. Japji is such an offering of Nanak. Never consider this story of Nanak disappearing in the river or drowning and then appearing in front of God literally. If you think so, then you are still infant, juvenile. You have only grown physically. Consciousness or wisdom has not yet born in you. What to do? Something sublime has to be communicated. Language is the only medium. This is the problem with the masters. They have to choose the words from the language. Words and languages, all irrespective of this or that, have their limitations. All that he wants to communicate is magnanimous and cannot be put into the words. Words are incapable to manifest its magnanimity. So, language remains the barrier always. When ego vanishes, the entire creation becomes godly. In that inner harmony and oneness, everything and everyone dances in that glory. Remember, God is not a person sitting somewhere and you have to be in front of him. God is an invisible energy field. Such an understanding comes out of maturity. How can you appear in front of that invisible energy field? When this happens, you see that invisible energy at work all around. It is this energy that surrounds you. It is this energy that blossoms through the flower. It is that energy that brings the rays of sun to you. It is in the chirping of the birds. It is in the waves all around. And then to say that Creator is separate from the creation is wrong and ignorance. Creator is hidden in his creation. And creation is nothing but the manifestation of the Creator. And Creator is the unmanifest creation. Creator is the unmanifest creation. And creation is the manifest Creator. Precisely, Creator is the process of creativity. Precisely, Creator is the process of creativity. God is an unmanifest power hidden within you. It is this power of energy field that knows beyond our finite understanding. And we are bound to each other by a causeless force. We are not aliens, nor as strangers meet. Instead, we are bound to each other by an invisible causeless force. Such an understanding is the beginning of inward journey. Ecstatic Kabir says, as long as I was, ego continued to function. No union with God was possible. And now that when God is, God has manifested, I cease to exist. I have disappeared. Ego has disappeared. The lanes of love are very narrow. Two can never dwell simultaneously. The rich or poor, king or the subject, whosoever this appeals can get it. Certainly not as he is. Certainly a price is for this. And what is the price? Your mind, your thoughts, your conditionings, your traditions and your dogmas too. And the price for this invaluable inner treasure of love. Indeed, your mind, your thoughts, your conditionings, your traditions and your dogmas too are the price for this invaluable inner treasure of love that you have to give. With ego and vanity, how can you be in front of him? Also, how can you be in such a presence that is not an ordinary presence? You cannot look towards the sun attentively, can you? The glare blinds you. Then how can you be in front of that which is 1,000 times more glowing than the sun? The day your inner vision opens, you will realize only that energy field surrounds you. Only you disappear, that is all. This cannot happen as long as you have ego. Ego is like a speck of dust in your eyes. The day your inner vision opens, you can realize only that energy field surrounds you. Only you disappear, that is all. This cannot happen as long as you have ego. Ego is like a speck of dust in your eye. With that speck, you cannot open your eyes. Because whenever there is a speck in your eyes, you cannot open your eyes. And with closed eyes, you cannot envision. Do not consider me literally. By opening the eye, I mean the disappearance of the speck of ego from your eye. The moment this speck is removed, the unknown and unknowable becomes visible to you. God is always. There was never a time when he was not, and also there will not be a time when he will not be. This is true of you as well. Only you are not available. Nanak disappeared, God appeared. Now God manifested through his very being and his presence. Remember, there is nothing except God. But God only appears through his creation and godliness. This is more sublime than God itself. Nanak, return as God. The man in him died. And now God is born in Nanak. After this happening, whatsoever Nanak said is precious. Every syllable is precious than the costliest gem. For each word or syllable, even the entire wealth is meaningless. Each syllable then is scripture. Each syllable is Veda. Now try to understand the message of Japji. Ek Onkar Satnam Karta Puruk Nirbhav Nirbhayat Akal Murat Ajuni Sambham Guru Parsad Chap. He is one. His very form is Onkar, the existential. He is Satnam, the truth. Embodiment of truth. Truth incarnate, the cosmic doer, beyond fear, beyond prejudice. Beyond time and space is his sublime existence. Born out of his own free will, he ever remains unborn. yet still he is the cause of his own existence. Such are the attributes, sacred and sublime. How can one attain to this presence? Certainly not by your own efforts alone. Be assured, by the grace of the Master, let this be your trust and certitude as well. All that we see around is many. Wherever you see division is, all around only duality and multiplicity is. You go to the seashore, only waves are visible. Ocean alone is. The waves are on the surface, yet still you do not see the ocean. You can see all that is on the surface. This is the only vision you have. You do not see beyond duality. To see beyond the outer, you need a different eye. As is your vision, so will be the scene. Whatever shade you have on your eyes will certainly give you the hue. Your awareness can never be deeper than your understanding. This is the reason that there are altered states of awareness. And Sufis call these as various states of nafs or ego. Nafs is a Sufi word for ego. And when you have the outer eye, then you can only see the waves. And then you will claim that you had been to the ocean. Use your intelligence to find answers yourself. This is not the way to go to the ocean. From the shore you only see the waves, because waves alone are visible. To know the ocean, you have to be in the ocean. This is the reason that Nanak drowned in the river. He is not lost in the waves. Instead, Nanak is deep within the river. Mystically, river symbolizes the being of an aspirant. And from the surface, whatsoever you will say will be false. How can you say that you have been to the ocean? A wave is not the ocean. And neither the sum total of waves is ocean. There is a fundamental difference between the ocean and a wave. Wave is short-lived. One moment before it was not, next moment it appears, and then following moment it is no more again. This is transitory. Such cannot be the taste of God. Can it be? Certainly not. Once there was a mystic, a Sufi master, his name was Junayd. He loved his son dearly. Suddenly one day the son died in an accident. Junayd cremated his son. This baffled his wife. Wife always thought that Junayd could never bear the agony of separation with his son. It appeared as if nothing had happened to Junayd. It appeared son has not yet died. Junayd remained unaffected. By evening everyone left. After expressing their condolences, an amazed wife inquired if he did not feel the agony. You loved your son so dearly that I thought that you may break apart with this. Junayd's response is significant. It reflects the mystery. It reflects the understanding of a master. One who has known how to be. For a moment I was taken aback. For a moment I was taken aback by the sudden demise. The same time I remembered something. There was a time when the sun was not and I was happy. And then the sun came, happiness remained. And now the sun is no more, then why lament? Happiness is there still. You think happiness increases or decreases. Happiness is not quantitative. Happiness is the quality of your being. It is that state. In that state, it is bliss. Happiness is the quality of your being, not quantitative, that will increase or decrease with something. Someone does a favor to you, your happiness increases. This is false. Happiness is an inner function. It has nothing to do with the outer. I am blissful because of a different reason. When the sun was not, I was not unhappy. then how can I be unhappy when sun is no more? Between these two happenings was a dream. Children are born through you, not from you. You are the doer. You are the mechanism that a child is conceived. A child is a gift from the unknown. Give him your love. Mind they will have of their own. Children are born through you, not from you. You are the doer. You are the mechanism that a child is conceived. A child is a gift from the unknown. Give him your love. Mind they will have of their own. Give them your love. Mind they will have of their own. And once you have given them your love, certainly something will evolve from within. And once you have given your love, certainly something will evolve from within. That which comes and disappears is dream. That which attains form and dissolves is dream. That which comes and disappears is dream. That which attains form and dissolves too is dream. Waves are dreamlike. Waves are numerous. Ocean is one. We can only see many. As long as we will not be able to see oneness, wandering will continue. The lament will continue. The agony, the pain, misery and despondency too will continue. Truth is solitary. Nanak sings, Ek Onkar Satnam Karta Purukh Nirbhav Nirbhay Akal Murat Ajuni Saibham Guru Prasad Ja. Ek Onkar Satnam Karta Purukh Nirbhav Nirbhay Akal Murat Ajuni Saibham Guru Prasad Ja. Ek Onkar Satnam. Only this much on this first talk, the excerpt from Ek Onkar Satnam, Heartbeat of Nanak. The book that is published from Author House in England, and it is available worldwide in America through Barnes & Nobles, Amazon, Waterstone in England, NILES in Australia and New Zealand, ALIBRIS, and many other stores and the sites worldwide, both in print form as well as in digital form.